And with that, we would like to see if there's any public comment on tonight's agenda items. I'll give it just a minute in case somebody is waiting to raise their hand.
Is that option available for attendees?
It is.
Because I don't see it.
Yeah, they should be able to raise their hands from there.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, seeing none, I'll go ahead and close public comments for tonight. Moving into the superintendent's report, 6.1, our fiscal year 21 budget presentation. Sandy, it's all you.
Great, thank you everybody. Pleasure to be here in my living room presenting my budget. That's a first for me in my career as a superintendent on a snowy night. But I'm very eager and excited to present the FY21 Leadership Council budget proposal. So as you can see, our mission statement is really what drives our work. It's our purpose, and it's why we exist. And it is a safe and an inclusive environment where each and every student is empowered to be a resilient, lifelong learner who is prepared to engage as a contributing member of society. Now, I'm gonna go to the next slide. Not allowing me to do that.
Kate, you're on mute.
Sandy, I just clicked it down for you. I've got my screen up, so I should be able to push it when you tell me so.
Okay, good. Thank you. So the objectives, really, of the first reading is the state of the state that I'll be doing tonight. Certainly, I'll be talking about the proposed budgets. It's an also an opportunity to talk about the good work that's going in our district. The Shared Leadership Council's budget proposal, we'll be talking about that, and we'll review the budget development process as well. We'll start the conversation with the school board vote on the reading of the FY21 budget proposal, and then we're prepared to refine our FY21 budget to maximize available resources and respond to the evolving student needs. Next slide, please. So some of the highlights, and I'm not going to read all of these, but I just want to acknowledge some of the good work that's going on in the district. Scarborough High School is ranked number 4, best high school in the state of Maine, according to the 2020 niche rate rankings. And that's the most recent ranking that I could find about our high school, came out in 2020. The second bullet, Scarborough High School is ranked number 8 best high school in the state of Maine, according to the 2009. Knowledge of the good rest of the slides that we have a high percentage of our students who graduate in 4 years and 5 years. And also we have many students who attend post-secondary education after graduation. And our advanced placement courses, I think people should be very proud of. We have 18 of those courses, and that really prepares our students for after Scarborough High School. And of course, our vocational schools, how blessed we are to have 2 of those schools in the greater Portland area where our students from Scarborough High School can attend those schools. Next slide, please.
Oh, geez. I'm stuck. Let's try this way.
Thank you. So Scarborough High School, again, as I look at the data, it ranks better than 95.7% of the public high schools in Maine. And that would be, we would be number 5 out of 117 high schools. the second bullet, Scarborough Middle School ranks better than 91.9% of the middle school students in Maine. We would be number 7 out of 86 middle schools. And Wentworth ranks better than 95.6% of elementary schools in Maine, which means that they're number 12 out of 275. That source is from schooldigger.com. Unfortunately, that do not show any data for elementary schools. Otherwise, I would have put that up. So we're doing a good job with our schools, and we'll go on to the next slide.
I think I might have went a little too fast that time. I'm a terrible driver.
So here's a little budget history. The gross budget, which is the total cost to deliver program services, has increased year to year at an average of 4.25%. And that increase is between the years of FY09 to FY20. Our state subsidy, our GPA, has decreased by $3.7 million, which is equivalent to minus 52.4%. from FY09 to FY20. And the local tax request has increased year to year with an average of 6.78% from FY09 to FY20. As you can tell, there's a revenue issue going on in the state, and we've had some challenges in the past. So I think as a community, Scarborough should be proud of you're getting a lot for your buck, bang for your buck, when you look at the per pupil expenses. You're a high performing competitive district. You should be proud of that. The median per pupil cost overall in this region, when you compare us to everybody else, we're number 5 of the 11 comparison districts. So overall, our per pupil cost certainly is not the highest. The gradual increase over the last 10 years we've had, the highest per pupil costs are for student instruction and support. So if you're gonna have a high per pupil cost, you might as well put it towards the students and the instruction. The lowest per pupil cost for our administration and operations is below the state average. If you take the 11 Cumberland County districts, our administrative cost is at the lowest compared to Cumberland County districts. At the bottom of the slide, if you want to look at a historical perspective of all these costs, that's where you would go. So the budget proposal goals. We want to provide an appropriate service based on student needs to encourage the best possible educational outcomes for all students. We want to respond to the increasing enrollment demands, particularly at K-2. It's been a challenge for us. We want to update the important curriculum and assessment tools because we're about teaching and learning. We want to prioritize support resources for data-driven teaching. We want to enhance and support for successful co-curricular programs, which we're very blessed to have a number of those programs in our district. And we want to maintain existing programs and ensure, of course, student safety. So let's talk about the cost drivers that's really driving the cost behind the budget here. As you know, salaries and benefits, collective bargaining agreements for the two largest district bargaining units are currently under the negotiation. If you look at salaries and benefits in this district, it's about 79 0.5% of your overall budget. So again, most of the money in any school system goes to the people who are working here. It's obviously, it's an expense, but it's about teachers and all the other administrators and custodians and cooks and bus drivers. It adds up, and that's where the salaries can go. In addition to that, we've seen increasing enrollment. You'll hear more, but just this coming year, we're looking at the elementary school. We're going to have to hire 4 new elementary teachers due to growth. The developmental, social, emotional, and behavior needs of our students continue to increase, not only here, but across the country. And we have to provide those services for all students. Our aging, overcrowded facilities at K-2 and the middle school is a need, and we're trying to address that the best way we can. And of course, about teaching and learning, curriculum and assessment updates need to happen. And those are considered within this budget as well. So some of the challenges: increase in enrollment, significant at the K-2 level. If you think about it, population in Scarborough back in 1961 was 6,418 residents. 2018, you have 20,352 residents. By 2025, we anticipate, with the research that we've done with an architect firm, that 45% of our primary students will be in portable classrooms. I want to repeat that. 45% of our primary students will be in portable classrooms that we project by 2025. Aging facilities, 3 primary schools. They were built in the 50s. They were renovated in the 80s. Each school is outfitted with additional portable classrooms due to over-enrollment. Thirdly, overcrowded schools. The middle school, that was constructed back in 1966. And shortly after that, it became overcrowded. The entire 6 grade classrooms are located in a non-attached portable classrooms. So we're here before you tonight. We know this is a starting point, and certainly this budget will be reviewed by the board and other residents. But I want you to look at the 2 circles to the right. That the total education budget at this point in time is 5.57%. If you scroll down to the bottom, the tax request, and go way over to the right where the green circle is, the percentage change would be 5.20%. Go on to the next slide. So how is the school operating budget allocated? If you look in the big blue circle, most of the money goes to salary and wages and benefits, almost at 80%. And I'm not going to go through all these little boxes, but at your leisure, I think you'll see how it's broken down everywhere from, you know, bus maintenance to supplies to contracted services. So it just gives you a graphic to see where the money goes. In addition, when we look at personnel costs, teachers and professionals in that big blue circle is just over 67%. And then it breaks down everything from district administration and support staff. You can scroll down more to bus drivers, and then it talks about informational technology staff. So again, it gives you a graphic of the personnel costs within our district. So items in motion. Typically, sometimes this time of year, we have not received the Anthem rates to be able to build into our budget, but we were very fortunate that they came in only at 1.775%. So we're able to build that into the budget. And in addition to that, our dental rates that we had budgeted at 4% came in at 3.35%. So other things that are in motion, our insurance premiums, workman's comp, property, casualty, our kindergarten enrollments, always a guess. We can estimate the best we can, but until we actually screen those kindergarten students and get them online, we don't have an accurate number until later on during the summer. Special ed costs, we have incoming students. Our special ed director works really hard to do some outreach and try to get a handle on what number of students are coming in and to what degree of services that they require. And certainly our collective bargaining with both teachers and professionals and educational staff is still in motion, and we look forward to getting those settled sooner than later. So level services, no new investment. So here, what we've done is we have line item review and reallocation to meet the current needs. We have individual meetings with each department and really scrutinize the budgets. We have staff budget listening sessions at each school. We did that, spent about a week, maybe a week and a half, going out to each school, offering to sit in the teacher's lunch room or their break room and listen to the teachers give us ideas about the budget, what are their challenges, what were things that we put in last year that they were grateful for. It was an opportunity to really drill down, listen to staff, which will inform how our budget was developed. And then we spent 20 plus hours to analyze the current budget and look at how we could reallocate resources. As we think about staff and analysis and reductions, we did reduce the budget proposal based on projected retirement and resignations. We always have turnovers each year, and we take that into consideration as we build a budget. We also reduced the budget proposal based on enrollment and looked at how that will impact class sizes. The essential investments, and this is where we begin to invest within the organization. And we have compliance and mandates and safety issues, to be honest with you. And so as you look at the box to the right, we are recommending to hire two K-2 behavior specialists. And that will be shared between special ed and general ed. We won't go into great detail about that job responsibility, but a lot of these behavior specialists really work to integrate special ed students into the regular classroom, or for some of those students, they may be pulled out. In addition to that, we're going to need another certified speech therapist assistant. That's mandated given certain numbers that can be on a speech therapist caseload, and we're at the point where we've exceeded those caseloads, and so we have to build another position into the budget. In addition, we're looking at special ed educational technicians. These are not teachers, these are ed techs that work in the buildings, and they do a variety of jobs, anywhere from helping regular ed students integrate into the classroom along with the classroom teacher working with the ed techs. Oftentimes these students may need to be pulled out, they may need to be isolated for a few minutes and have some downtime. A lot of these students want to get outside during recess, and they need somebody to assist them as well. It depends on the type of needs, obviously. But we are proposing, and we're, to be honest with you, we're mandated to have these positions due to the safety and the compliance and the rules and regulations under special ed. So the good and bad news is the good news that Scarborough's a popular place. It's a great town. You have great schools and people are moving in. As a result of that, we anticipate that we will need 4 K through teachers to be hired based on the enrollment that's coming in. So we'll hire 2 teachers for Blue Point and 2 teachers at 8 Corners, 1 teacher at Blue Point and 1 at Pleasant Hill. So that's a combination of 4 teachers that based on enrollment that we anticipate that's been built into the budget. When you have 4 classroom teachers, you need to make sure you have supplies ready. So we've built in just over $16,000 to pay for those classroom teachers positions and classroom materials. So in this, at Wentworth School, the leadership team has provided release time to allow a lead teacher the support for the sciences. A lot of good stuff going on with that and trying to coordinate science and support for people along with 504s. That's again, kind of falls under the special ed. And we have many opportunities at Wentworth for after school activities. And so there's no cost to this, it's a realignment of monies. And so we just wanted to acknowledge that we did not add this into the budget. We're able to find other ways to pay for this that we reduced or gave up. But I wanted to mention that those are some needs and we're going to address them this coming year. In addition, we're proposing 3 full-time K-2 building ed techs. These people do many different roles at the elementary schools, and it could be anything, again, to working in the classrooms, to pulling students out of the classroom, to give them sort of some downtime. They're in the lunchroom. They may be doing clerical work, although I would say most of them are really working with students and working with classroom teachers. This has been one area that I've noticed that I feel that we have not invested enough just from my being in other districts. I really have to tell you, we're very lean with building ed techs, trying to get students off the bus, into their school, into the right classroom, trying to get students into line and going out for recess. Again, going to the lunchroom and coordinating all that. There's a lot of work during the day to make sure students go to the right spot. And teachers have really been, I would say, very tolerant not to have the number of ed techs that they should have. So this has been a need. So again, our level 3 investment, we want to update our K-8 mathematics curriculum, and that will allow us to access online resources. This is an important content area, just like all the others are. And this is a need. In addition, the investment level 4, unified sports, not a lot of money, just over $9,100. But this will fully fund our high school and middle school programs. And I have to tell you, if you haven't gone to a unified sporting event, you need to go. The excitement for these students from the fans is amazing. The unified sports is just an incredible opportunity to integrate these students into our athletic program. investment level 5. We would like to update our middle school world language curriculum. We purchased online materials to allow 6 through 12. And now we feel it's time to align this program so it's middle school all the way up to the high school. Investment level 3, iReady student assessment program. It adopts successful software program, which we piloted in FY20. And this is data that will drive our teaching. And it's an important piece of our program. There's no way that you can teach without having data to inform instruction. Come back to that one. So investment level 7, co-curricular funding. This would be an opportunity to actually fund the high school and middle school clubs that are currently operating without any budget support. And we just feel now is the time to build this into the budget. So this budget does allow us, I'm not going to go through this and read it, but I just want you to kind of look at different areas where we were responding to certain things, we're providing funding for certain things, we're expanding certain programs like Unified Sports, we're updating curriculum components, and we're supporting our data-driven teaching components. So this is just a graphic to kind of talk about responding, providing, supporting, updating, and it all filters within our budget that I talked about tonight. This is not a time for me to whine about unmet needs. I understand that we cannot have everything in 1 year. But I feel obligated to let people know in the public that we do have the following items that are not built into the budget. And we did build these in, but they just did not make it. It's not that they're not important, but we have so many other needs just with 4 classroom teachers at the elementary level is an example. So again, these are some areas that maybe down the road we can look at. Very important components of our schools, but at this point in time, we just can't feel like we could add it to the budget. We do want to hear from you. We want you involved. I think it's important as a community member to understand the school budget. Our town council first reading, again, these are some of the dates that have going to be taking place, and we want you to watch us and ask questions and be involved. If we can assist you in any way, if you're not able to get online or watch these hearings or the reviews or second readings or whatever, we will try to get information or answers to you accordingly. So please be involved, and I thank you. I appreciate your time on this beautiful snowy night. I know this is a process. I know that we're in tough economic times and we're sensitive to that. And we want you to know at the same time, the needs of your district, the wants that we have put forth has been very collaborative with all our administrative team. And I think the tough job from here on out is what can we really, with a straight face at the end of the day, provide a budget that will support our students and be affordable to the Scarborough community. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandy. I would like to say that it's incredible how much has gone into pulling together this budget, especially in the midst of everything else that the leadership team has done over the last 3 weeks in deploying 3,000 students and our entire staff for remote learning, as well as keeping the budget going. Thank you so much for all of the energy and effort to get everything met on time and to provide us with a really solid overview of what the district needs.
Thank you.
Moving into new business, 7.1, it's a first reading of the proposed FY21 school budget. And I'll turn this over to Sarah.
All right, guys, I'm really nervous. A lot of numbers to read off. So I think I've forwarded you guys the four motions that are on the table. What I'd like to do is read the operating, do the general fund operating budget as one, the adult education, school nutrition, I'll combine, and then do the capital improvements as a third one. So I know that's a lot of roll call for you, Diane. So apologies, but so I'd like to make a motion to adopt the Leadership Council's budget proposal as presented for first reading. The total general fund operating budget is proposed as $54,371,806, with offsetting non-tax revenues of $4,715,887, and a tax request to the town of $49,655,919.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. And discussion? April?
April has her hand up.
Yeah. I just want to say thank you so much to our leadership team and to our administration for putting together a budget that meets our agreed upon first reading goal that we set with the as a joint town council and school board finance committee. We agreed that we would try and come in at less than 6% net budget increase. And of course, those goals were set back in the fall. But we a significant amount of work and thought really went into setting those goals. And I'm just so appreciative of all the work that goes into the budget every year. It's really unfortunate that we find ourselves in a position now where we're going to have to really scrutinize what is otherwise a really lovely budget. So thank you very much, guys.
April? Oh, Sarah.
Yeah, Leanne, I don't know if this is the appropriate opportunity to have this discussion, so stop me if it's not, but you know, obviously all of us joined and listened to the town council meeting last night, and I think just to go sort of add on to what April said, it's evident that there will be some adjustments that are going to be required to our budget. The process for how we get to those adjustments is still being worked out, but one of the things that has been proposed by the town council is for us to meet as a joint finance committee and really figure out how we move forward. One of the options is for them to just give us direction and say, you got to get it to X. And other options are maybe we come up with something more collaboratively. So I think it would be important for at least me to hear, hopefully everybody else would feel this way as well, from Kate and Sandy and Diane as to sort of what your preference is in terms of the working practices and how we get from where we are now, hopefully after our first reading, to inevitably their first reading, which will have some reductions, and then to second reading after that. So that being said, I don't know, Leanne, if you want me to table, if we want to table that and have that conversation after the vote, or if now is appropriate.
I think now is appropriate, especially as we're getting ready to approve those numbers. I will say that I'm appreciative that we can work collaboratively with the council in order, you know, to look at where our opportunities may be. It speaks volumes to the relationship that's been built between the two finance committees, that we are able to work through this as a town and really come back with what is in the best interest of everybody, from our students to our taxpayers. Nick?
I didn't know if I should also raise my hand physically. I guess, so I don't want to add too much to what everyone has said, because I think you've all said it. And certainly all of us that were watching the town council meeting last night empathized with their situation and the situation we're in now. I mean, Sandy, I want to thank you for the particular slide you showed about the effort that goes into just calculating level services, because I know there are still people out there who may think that it's a matter of changing the 19s to 20s and the 20s to 21s, but in reality, it's a lot of work to figure out how you can move resources around to have a level, to have level services, but knowing that level services from year to year change because of the demands of our student population and our professionals. So I wanna thank you guys for doing that. This process takes a long time, and what's evolved over the course of the last, you know, 45 to 60 days has drastically changed the landscape of our community economically as well as health-wise. So hence we're all in this Brady Bunch style format. So, you know, I just wanna thank everyone for all the hard work they've done. We all know, I think everyone here can agree, that there's work to be done, uncomfortable work that doesn't say anything negative about the incredible process you guys have already gone through. So I just wanna to make that clear from my perspective.
Thank you.
Alicia?
Thank you. I'd like to thank the leadership team as well for all of the efforts that they've put in to come up with this budget. I think seeing the comparison numbers and the actual data is really important, because you hear, or at least I hear, a lot of rhetoric about spending. And when you see where we compare to other districts and you see the actual data, you realize that it really is a lot of rhetoric. And I also think it's important to look at the unmet needs, because they're not frivolous things that we're not able to purchase for our students or support or for our students. There are things that are really necessary, and those are things that we can't even get to. And so I'm proud of the team that they were able to meet the goal after a lot of hard work and came in under goal. And I know that it may require some additional adjustment. And knowing how much need there is in the changing demographics of our town, that's a scary thought for me, that we have to do that. But I'm gonna remain optimistic that we can work collaboratively with the town and still really meet the needs of the students in doing that.
Agreed. All right, any other comments? Seeing none, I think we're ready to vote on the first of the motions.
Ms. Dorgan?
Yes.
Mrs. Giftos?
Yes.
Dr. Gill?
Yes.
Ms. Cazalonis?
Yes.
Ms. Layton?
Yes.
Mrs. Seither?
Yes.
Mrs. Turner?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
And Mr. Bennett?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Ready when you are, Sarah, for motion number two.
On to the next. So move to adopt the adult education budget as presented for first reading. The total adult education budget is proposed at $198,188, with offsetting non-tax revenues of $103,188 and a tax request to the town of $95,000. And move to adopt the school nutrition budget as presented for first reading. The total school nutrition budget is proposed at $1,777,105, with offsetting non-tax revenues of $1,577,105 and a tax request to the town of $200,000.
So moved.
Second.
And discussion. Seeing none, I think we're ready to take the vote.
Ms. Durgan?
Yes.
Mrs. Giftos?
Yes.
Dr. Gill?
Yes.
Ms. Cavalonis?
Yes.
Mrs. Layton?
Yes.
Mrs. Scyther?
Yes.
Mrs. Turner?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yes.
And Mr. Bennett?
Yes.
Correct.
Okay. And finally, move to adopt the capital improvements budget as presented for first reading. Capital equipment budget, proposed budget is $1,152,079. And the capital project proposed budget is $1,981,162.
So moved.
Second.
And any discussion? Okay. Seeing none, ready to vote.
Ms. Durgan?
Yes.
Mrs. Giftos?
Yes.
Dr. Gill?
Yes.
Ms. Cazalonis?
Yes.
Ms. Layton?
Yes.
Mrs. Scyther?
Yeah.
Mrs. Turner?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell?
Yeah.
And Mr. Bennett?
Yes.
Great. Thank you, everyone. All right, moving on. 7.2 is a motion to enter into executive session pursuant to Title I MRSA 4056C for the purpose of discussing the disposition of property or economic development as it relates to the proposed primary building project, to return to public session for any possible action.
So moved.
Second.
Just one quick mention on this. For folks at home, if you are gonna join us again, there is a second link to rejoin the meeting for when we do come back. Otherwise, thank you very much. Have a great night, and for the panelists, I'll see you on the next meeting.
Thank you. Do we need a vote?
Oh, yeah. Hey, how about that? We do need a vote.
Ms. Durgan?
Yes.
Mrs. Giftos?
Yes.
Dr. Gill?
Yes.
Ms. Cazalonis?
Oh, yeah.
Ms. Layton?
Yes.
Mrs. Scyther?
Yes.
Ms. Turner?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell? And Mr. Bennett.
Heck yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.